Okay, then maybe I can start a bit already. Okay. So anyone still stuck at CA1? Like your program cannot run. I know you're okay lah. You're fine. First to submit, he's done. The rest, you have any issue with CA1, like the program cannot run or bugs? No. Okay. So maybe what I can do is have a bit of consolidation about what's there so far. There's a cough or flu going around, so please take care. A lot of people are falling sick from cough. Hey, so let's take a look at what you have. Hello. Okay, so a bit of recap on what's been done. So before the holidays, and maybe recently you submitted your CA1, and CA1, you have your CA1 probably has something similar to here, the structure. Okay. So in a sense, if you have what you cover in for your assignment, first assignment, you already have kind of quite a fairly number good number of features in your web services that you've done. For the simplest fact of having like your resources to do like get and post requests. Okay, so let's look at our CA1 requirements and take map from there. Okay. Sorry, wrong assignment. Not this version. Okay, date of course been extended. So your first assignment has the features of registration, login, and we also covered a bit more in that, which is based on the code here. Authentication using JWTs, the web tokens, bearer. Okay. Other than that, we also have a couple more like methods that we have here. We also went through the security, the role declaration annotations like this roles allowed. Okay, so if you ask a question like what's missing from your project right to the full web services REST implementation, I will show you now what exactly is the next step. The next step will actually build on to your assignment 2, and it's not very far, frankly. Actually, you all did like a lot more here than the code assignment 2. So in terms of the topics, literally you've covered up to four. So highlight just the ones you've not done yet officially, because they are lesser. Topic 5, content negotiation. You've not done that yet. Topic 6, headers. That's quite straightforward to do. API versioning and pagination. So if I were to sum up, basically you have topic 5, 6, and 7 more to finish before you actually have assignment 2 ready. So in a way, you've actually gone through quite a lot by doing assignment one. Okay, this is a bit different from my previous class style where we actually do just purely theory and design in assignment one, not so much coding. Then all the coding goes in assignment two. So I think in that sense, we can focus a bit more on revision for the test and also making sure that you know get these things firm up. So here, when I look at these 5 items: content negotiation, headers, and API versioning and pagination. Basically, these are all features in your API implementation that you will definitely find very useful over time. And we'll talk about the reasons why these things are important. right? So if you look at topic 5, it will cover content negotiation today. It's not very difficult. In fact, content negotiation is fairly easy, very easy to understand. So content negotiation happens as part of a process when taking the same data needs to be same data can be returned in various formats. So in terms of what do you mean by same data and coming in different formats, you can say, can I have the data in plain text, XML or JSON? So that's one example. Other examples of content negotiation can be language or content specific. Like some web services return you content in English, you can request for same content in maybe German or another language. It's really dependent on what your web services have implemented on the back end. So if we look at the definition, yeah, it's just a mechanism that's part of the HTTP definition. Same URI, there's no change in the path, but you can serve different versions of the document or the different version of the same data. So typically different versions, you can look at it as one example, which is like the format of the data. Very often you'll come across this thing called content type, which is what you specify. So as a requester to your web services or your Android application, you can specify the content type. And using these MIME types here, application JSON, application XML, you can say what you want the return to be. You also inversely can tell the REST API what kind of format data you're sending by this. So other examples could be language, but examples like this, like language, is very specific. They are dependent on whether you implement this feature in the backend. If you've not implemented this feature, your web service will not automatically translate for you. So you may want to plug into Google Translate or Amazon Web Services, there's some translation services to do this kind of translation. But out of the box, this is XML JSON, it is quite straightforward to implement. So content types are counted. They're also called MIME types, and there's a lot of different sets of it. Now, when you do content negotiation, we actually need to look at either server-side driven or client-side driven, which basically means there are two aspects you need to implement. One is, what does your server decide to return if, let's say, nothing was specified? Okay, so that is your web services. Client-side will be your Android application. Like, do you need to always tell the server what kind of format you want? Most commonly, it will be the content type or MIME type. Sometimes it can even be like media types. Example, let's say you want an image. Images, you know, you have different formats. JPEG, GIF, PNG, BMP, TIFF, right? So even though the media like videos, MP3, MP4, AVI, or such, right? You may want to like, specify the content type to request from the server. So all this is part of the content negotiation process. So when we talk about server-side driven, is basically the server is basically waiting for the client to say what format you want. So if the client essentially specifies, I accept a certain type of data, content type, then the server will serve it. Now if the client doesn't say, then the server will decide. So in this aspect, in later in the code, you will see how you can actually determine the order of priority. So it's like saying, hey, I want fries, but I want potatoes, then you want potatoes in what kind? Fried or baked? You never say that, I'll just give you big by default. So there's a certain priority in how you encode that in your web services. Good thing is, it's not very difficult to do it. It's actually a one-liner. It's just the heavier lifting is whether you're dealing with content types or maybe like more heavy things like translation, maybe like video or file encoding and such. That one would be more difficult. So client-side, you can also specify is, if client do not if the client says, I only want a certain format, and then you should specify in the so-called accept headers. So we'll go a little bit into the different type of headers, or the headers specifically for needed for content negotiation work. So this header, which is the accept header, specifically is issued from the client, which is your Android application. So it's like saying, I accept content type, your application JSON. I accept this character set. I accept maybe you need to give me in a compressed format. In whatever format, I accept the certain languages. So this accept headers actually tile headers you will use from the Android application to request what you want from the server. So here are some examples. Character set. Typically, character set will be like a certain ISO format. So what are character sets? Will be your text file format. So if you look at text, plain text, something, say example, you type something in your notepad in Windows or Mac in TextMaker, and you save it. Okay, so a lot of us will just use it, but without understanding what exactly format, what format entails. So to the system or the OS, there are different type of formats it saves text file in. The most common format is called UTF-8. Okay, so UTF-8 is a text format that allows maybe like multiple languages to be embedded inside. ISO-A59 is also one type of format. Traditionally, you also look at ASCII, or sometimes they have what Bitindian, Small Indian, and different kind of formats. So certain formats are there because the text allows certain text to be saved. Old days when we save text, we can actually save like East Asian languages text content because it's not UTF-8. So later on, a lot of text formats tend to go towards UTF-8 version. Okay. Encoding is also another header. So encoding, this is a very built-in feature for most servers. So in fact, this is handled at the server level. Example, if you are setting up an Apache server, most of your responses will be compressed by default. Okay, so basically they use this thing called gzip. In some servers, in other servers, they may use a different kind of encoding format. So this is a typical kind of compression. The reason why they compress is just to make the content smaller so it travels through the internet faster. And a lot of your client, like browsers, applications, actually have a mechanism to handle it. Now, if I'm talking about Android application, how is Android going to like consume the data? If you're sending in text, generally it's not an issue, unless you are specifying a very specific type of compression, then maybe you need to have a library on your Android application to do a decompression. Okay, sorry, typo here, not character set, language. So this is not character set, it's language. So in language, asset language, here, English this part, you can especially specify the language code. Typical codes like DE for German, EN for English. Okay. So this is very dependent on the feature of your application. If your application needs to translate content or get content from the API that's translated, then you want to use asset language. So ongoing now, we will just show you what is the actual coding you need for your Java web services. So looking at this thing as another annotation. So this annotation is basically implanted into your resources. So where your classes are returning responses. So every method, you can actually put in this annotation to say what is the order of the data type you want to return. So we're going to look at content type or MIME types as an example. So this is simplest to do. So this produces, so remember you have a producers tag. So let me go back to the Eclipse. Okay. So maybe I'll take a look at the transactions Java. So if you look at transaction Java or users here, right? Okay. New transaction. So transaction here, you have a couple of methods. For example, this get user or add transaction. So far, we haven't used the producers yet. Think so. Yes. So you have a consumes for users, you have a consume as well. Okay. And yeah, this doesn't have it. Okay. So the tag that we're gonna introduce into your program is called producers. So producers actually specify what is the type format you want to return. And you can actually put it in line with here. So example, let's say okay, so I have a get all method. Transaction. So the idea here is to get all transaction of a particular user, right, or all transaction in the system, depending. This will be all transaction in the system. So when we add in the add producers, what are we trying to do here in this case is to specify to your Java program that your response for the method should be returning data in this particular formats. Now, you should only actually have one type of producer. So let me just put in the basic one. Normally, if you say you have only one standard format of data to return in every response and it's a JSON, you will probably type in this producers application JSON. It's quite similar to how the consumes is like. Okay, so consumes will be what's the format is the endpoint is expecting in the request, produces what is the format it's going to spit out. Now you can actually have multiple producers. So one method can have JSON or XML. However, you can't do it like this, right? So the question here more to Java when it compiles this will be like, so which one comes first, right? JSON XML. So say you can return two different types. So this is where the content negotiation introduces one more little parameter you can use called the QS. The QS here basically defines which is the format you will return based on the weight. The QS value can range from 0 to 1, and the heavier value, 1, represents the most important or the first default. So in order to, let's say, for you, this user's method to return based on if it's a preferred one, let's say the client doesn't specify the accept content type, then all I need to do is to add in the QS. So after JSON, you use a semicolon and put in the QS value here. After XML, you can use a semicolon and put in the next QS value here. So the values between these two are arbitrary, determined by you, as long as you have defined one which is heavier than the other. And the heaviest one, which is 1, will get the priority. So this is content negotiation. Quite straightforward, right? In a nutshell. So let's go back to the slide. So your client, how does your client tell the your REST service what it wants? So if your client, your Android application were to say, I only use JSON, then I will send in my request header this header called accept application / JSON. Now if the Android application is kind of flexible, you can take any format, then you need either omit this header or you can send application / star. Then your server will decide that XML will be the default here. Okay. Now, what happens if the Android application or the client application, maybe not Android application, but somewhere else that's going to consume API, specifies a format that it doesn't have? Like, you can only offer XML and JSON, and then for some reason the client says, give me text plain. So this will result in basically a 406 not acceptable. So this automatically the server will actually return this 406 because it cannot find a matching MIME type for your producers here for the response. Now, if you come across the error 406, right, for yourself, this is maybe a good way to one of the possible reasons why your call is not working. You're asking for the wrong format. Okay, so I'm going to try to actually write this in code here. Let's see. So I have create, I have this, and I have a get all. So I'm going to play around with the get all method here. Am I going to return anything? Yes, I should. So, let's see. Okay, so to get started, so I'm going to make maybe a mock user object. Or maybe I can reuse the user object from here. Create user. No, man, I'll just create a new model. So I'll create a new model that is meant for returning users, and then I'll just return one sample dummy data here to see how it looks like. So maybe this is the get user model class. Okay. Probably very similar to this guy. For the moment, I just copy that over. Okay. You notice I'm actually pulling in all the XML stuff because my method here under users. Oh sorry, transaction should be transaction. Let me take this away. Wrong class. I should be returning transaction object. Let me see, do I have a transaction object? Yes, a transaction. Okay. Create a transaction. Take away this one. That over, okay. going to add the XML annotation here. Our reason why I'm going to add XML annotation is because my method here response allows me to return XML format. So when you're doing this, you have to take note that if you're going to return certain object, you probably need to necessary steps to modify your classes so you can return the correct data. Someone dummy object C file. Okay, so before I do anything, I need to get my token. So when I do the get transaction now, okay, so my get transaction in Postman. So if you think about your Android application, if you send a request to this to get transactions and have not specified a header, so you don't say what you accept, right? So your training here is a JSON format. So according to our transactions, yeah, JSON format is a preferred mode of transport. Now let's ask it to give me XML. So in your somewhere in your Android application or your client, okay, when you send a request, you can actually add in the headers. In this case, like I will say I want it to give me a transport in XML, then I'll just say accept and reach XML. Send. Yep. And so you should be able to see the format return in different format data. So the data is the same, except the format has changed now to XML. And XML will be based on how you actually like do the XML annotation in your class. Actually, it depends on what you want to return. Okay. So as simple as that, this is content negotiation. In the bare bone way. Let's try to ask for something that doesn't exist. Okay. Plain text or text plain, right? Yeah. You get a 4.6.7. So this is content negotiation. Specific to what your response is in terms of format. Oh, clear so far? So this part is very fast. It's really quick to go through. Any questions about content negotiation? No. Okay. So use case for this, if you effectively only have one client which is your Android application talking to your REST API, you probably won't use this. Because you already decided what kind of format you want your Android application to receive. Now if you're producing your API for different clients, that means unknown universal clients, like could be an iOS app, could be another person writing C#, Python program or PHP somewhere right to consume. You may give a choice of different formats. Why? Because maybe some systems prefer to use like XML in this case, okay, and such. So okay, so this is covered. Is content negotiation really fast? I'll move on to the next item. Will be headers. Okay. Okay. So HEDIOS is basically stands for a very long string of text here, meaning hypertext as an engine application state. So what HEDIOS actually means, or what it's trying to achieve, is basically the same idea or concept when you're browsing a web page. So when you're browsing a web page, normally the web page will have links. The links will bring you to another section. Or example, if you're reading like maybe Channel News Asia Online, so the first page will display the list of news, which is a short snippet. It will give you the title and maybe a very short description, excerpt of the news content. But when you click into that one news item, it gives you the full content, right? So the idea of hypertext as an engine of application state is to create a sense of state in a stateless, internally stateless system. So what I mean is when you're getting data from an endpoint, example like this, in XML format, say you were to get PSI from, let's say, an endpoint. So other than the PSI giving you the numbers generally for each section or each district or area of the map, it can also give you links to additional information. So how you design the links, or how you determine what links to provide, it will be up to your design. In this case, you can actually have, for example, links to retrieve the history of all the different areas, or links to retrieve specific details about a particular area here. So imagine the links here are like your hyperlinks on the web page. So this is the idea of application creating a state in your endpoints. So your endpoints, when they're returning data, they can be completely look like they have state because of one, the parameters that's been sent over, the data that's contextually related to the request, example, a user, And it's almost like a tree you can traverse. Like from PSI here, I can go to history. Here I can go to different areas, and each area has also its own like history of data. So this is the general idea of implementing a state in your REST endpoints. Same version can also be applied to JSON response. Now, how will you decide that whether it should be called underscore links or just call links or href? It's completely dependent on you implementing it. Today, there's no fixed standard for implementing HTOS. Basically, it's up to how you want to set up. But a lot of endpoints or web services on the market have some way of implementing this so far. So if you look, come back to how mature your REST services are, when you introduce HTOS, basically it's level 3 hypermedia controls. So your endpoints are not just data that's returned. The data may change. The data gives context and direction to how your client can explore more information. One of the latest, or not so latest, but a very brave step in this area, level 3 in the industry, is this thing called PropQL. So PropQL is said to be like a way of implementing web services that will take over REST. But PropQL is very specific because PropQL actually came out from Facebook. The idea that information has depth and you need to have a way to explore information without being constrained by the rules of paths and such. So if I were to give you access to a huge database, I would normally typically REST, I would say here are all the resources and here are all the endpoints, here are the methods you can do, and that's it. GraphQL tries to counter the problem by saying here is one single endpoint you can call to and here are the rules for navigating inside. For example, if I want to go to the next level, I can retrieve by certain parameters in the next level, and I'm like almost like reading a book and going through a trail like this. So GraphQL attempts to, let's say, make it somewhat systematic and logical to explore information, but this is very suitable for large data sets. If you're implementing, like in this case, your web services for an app, you may not actually want to use GraphQL at all. So if you want to learn this, fairly steep learning curve to understand the ideas. In terms of the industry standard, if you say GraphQL, you might not typically hear, I think people have actually contributed what they think should be standard for doing this. So we come back to hypermedia controls. So what we want to do with hypermedia controls, attempt to do, is to reduce the coupling between the mobile client application on the API. Coupling means awareness. For example, if I'm getting, let's say, a user, so I know I get a user detail. Can I like have a logical way of going to the user transaction? Or in this case, maybe user's context address book. So by providing the links in the response, you usually give your endpoint a way to like get the data. So in a sense, you don't need to actually, your application doesn't need to remember the endpoints, but follow the flow of the data. You can also control the access by providing the calls only client can make. So instead of giving her your client application the whole library of endpoints, you can now determine like if it's like a breadcrumb trail. If you go to this point in the junction, you can only go to option A, B, and C. That's because the data is such, right? So this is one of the advantages of using this. You can control this completely on the server side. And you can make maybe modifications to API paths without actually impacting the client app that much. This is another example from PayPal. So PayPal has an extensive web services they created for developers to integrate to their payment system. And what they actually did is within the payment system, they actually included links that you can do further actions on. So these links here, they call it links, which is very similar to what you have called, you call links on your HTML. href, rel, basically stands for relation and method for get. So href actually refers to the hyperlink. And in the href here, you notice that, okay, so there's a special token number behind, okay? Yeah, so all these numbers here, these few numbers here are completely dynamic based on which user you are and what you're doing. So in a single request, you can actually do a payment sale based on this, say, invoice ID or payment token that PayPal gave you. And they also tell you what method to use when you're making the call. So this is one way that PayPal is like implementing application state into their responses, so that your application, your endpoint, or your application client can actually reuse this data that's returned by PayPal. And if it doesn't exist, that means you can't do a certain action. For example here, a payment sale, confirming a sale, confirming a payment. So how do we design around Helios? So I'm gonna go straight to our money transfer app. So in the money transfer app, we have a couple of resources here that is kind of like the beginning of the whole thing, whole deal. So the user's resources is meant right now to create or register a user. However, it can also be used to return maybe the login user profile. So let's think of it logically. So I'm gonna design it in Notepad first to see where it goes to. So if I add users, okay. So it gives, what does users give me? Give me my profile information. Okay. And the user also has inherently transactions. So think about what makes up a user in your project. Profile transactions. Could be contacts, that means people they transfer money to, people receive money from. Okay, so with these three basic information, you are given a choice. When you return a user information, do you want to return everything? It means these three pieces of information in one go, or you don't. So the answer to that is, what does your app show? So if your app is going to show only one screen at a time, which is profile screen, and for transaction is another screen, for context is another screen. You don't necessarily need to always return these three information at the same time. We call for user slash maybe user ID. So how do you get around this problem? Is you start to separate your data. So if I want to get profile, okay. So by doing a get users with a supply ID, I return just the profile information, which is for my view my profile screen or my account screen. And it may have actions like change password, update name, and all that, right? So how do your application know that there is a thing called transactions from this? So in your screen, maybe you have a link to say, maybe your screen has a view profile, you have a transactions and also a context. So you might have things like this link. You could call it a label. So a lot of things here that you do is there really no standard rule of governing on how you should do it. But generally, you do what is more considered convenient for your application, but also ensure that it's sort of scalable at the end of the day when you want to make upgrades. So it could be something like this. So here I'm going to provide three information that will be useful to the app. One is the label, maybe what's displayed in the app itself. Second, the URL, and then the method to use when calling this URL. So this is one example of how I may incorporate transactions as a link rather than as data. So the reason why, because also partly transactions can have a lot of information, so I may not want to return them together a profile because it's not going to be useful all the time. So only when I go into transactions, then okay. So then I return like a list, a page list, information transactions. So how do I do contacts? So if I have like a lot of links, so I'm imagining that maybe in my Android application I have sort of a submenu when I go into view the user profile, and the submenu will have information. One button that links to transaction and another button that links to context. So in essence, when I do this, I sort of created a kind of state of the user in the profile. So a lot of ways of getting around this. You can also expand further. So as you expand further, you'll be thinking, okay, so I'm a user's profile, my endpoint should return data like this. It's a link to transactions. Then go to transactions, what kind of data should return? And then transactions, maybe have each transaction has a certain link. For example, let's say you send money to somebody. Okay, then your system is very smart. System says, okay, within the first 24 hours, you can cancel. Okay, you will not commit yet. So within the first 24 hours, we retrieve the rest endpoint for transaction for that transaction. There's actually a method there that says cancel. Now, the 24 hours have passed already. Then you go back to get the object data, the endpoint now will not have that option to cancel. So this logic is completely controlled on your server side. But it's useful for your application to know that, oh, now it's there, now it's not there. So instead of application thinking, I need to do a check. Can this user maybe check the transaction date, compare with when it was sent? Is it 24 hours? Then I should show the button. I don't do that. I just check whether the data has it. So data itself contains a state to tell you, oh, now the data allows you to do option A. But maybe tomorrow the data doesn't want to do option A, no, because of the business rule. And the business rule is controlled in your backend. So you have more of the business rule in your server-side implementation rather than in your Android application. The reason why we want to consolidate a lot of business rules in the server side is because we try to consolidate so it's easier to maintain. And one of the horror or nightmare of application development is that when you want to figure out something, you realize that you want to do one thing, but that one thing needs to be done in five different places, right? So we always look at that as very inefficient, so we want to avoid that situation. So this is one way to avoid that situation. Okay, so how do you implement this? Okay, so to implement this, you'll be creating a lot of classes. But there's one, as you make a few of these things, you can make one class that you can reuse. For example, in this case, this link object. So this object itself, okay, this object itself can be reused. Then you come up with your own standard. Like I said, there's no universal standard for this. So your own standard in your application to do this, you write your object, a link object contains a label, a URL method, and then I just reuse it whenever my responses are returned in the class. Okay. And then I will decide when I should put it in and when I should not. Right. So that you can get around it. So frameworks, well, I think you can, if you want to try frameworks that lessen your work, you might want to look around. Personally, I haven't found any framework that kind of like gives a standard model. So really leave it to your own creativity, how you want to do this thing. So some people may not call this URL, they can call this href. I emphasize again, it's completely up to how you want it. Okay, so it's your call. Right, so this is HDOS. So when you think about HDOS, you have to think about state. So a lot more thinking comes in place when when you return the data, you think about, okay, now the data has A, B, and C. Maybe it doesn't have A and B later on because of certain reason. And that's all based on your application logic. Any questions about HDOS so far? I'll do a code run through, implement it. This is recorded anyway, so I'll implement it into the project and you can see how, maybe implement a simple one like this, it works. I guess it's a lot of hard work just creating the classes to title up, but more than just typing on the thing is the thinking on what your application, what kind of business logic application you have that determine the data. Okay, so if not, I will go to the next item, which is a feature also. Versioning and pagination. So versioning and pagination are the last two features of your REST API design implementation. So we talk about versioning first. So versioning first is, okay, you download apps on Play Store or App Store and Play Store, right? How many times the system tells you to update the app? Quite often, right? You always get this, right? Oh, you need to update the app before you start using it again. Okay. So think about this. Now you launch your application. 3 months down the road, you decided you must meet a release an update. Okay, update can be for many reasons. Number one, you introduce new features. Number two, you have some bugs to fix. I think 70% of the time is fixing bugs. So whenever you see the update, right, the list of things that change, you say, oh, bugs A, B, C, and whatever fix, some optimization, performance improvement, and stuff. Okay, so what does it imply or implicate to your REST services when you make updates, especially features? So today, version 1, right, I return get users. Oh, it just returns 3 different information. Okay, assuming this is version 1. Okay, for sake of simplicity, you design out the 2 HTOs, you just get user ID, throw everything back at the endpoint, back at the Android application. Then 3 months later down the road, you realize it's not a good idea because every time people just view a view profile, number one, it chalks out your network bandwidth from the server because you're spitting out too much information that they don't really need to use. Although it's a very quick and hacky way to do it and launch it. So you decided, let's make a better version like the one below. Okay. Now the problem is your Android application, when you receive user information, you will expect to have transaction and context. Right? So if you suddenly change, that means you need to change both sides, your endpoint and your Android app. No problem, just change. Now, the market is such that 1 million person will download their app, maybe half of them actually don't realize they need to update. They're still using the old version. Okay, so you have one problem. Half 500,000 users using the first version of that. Okay, then if you were to roll out your endpoint with the second version, right, and your update endpoint first place, and then you roll out your app update version 0.2 of your app on the market, the half of them download the version 0.2, half of them use the version 1. What do you think is going to happen? So how does version 1 know that it's, when it says get users 101, right, it's going to get this or this? Okay. Now that both URLs are the same. Well, a simple way to do this is that, oh, maybe my version 1.2 application, I'll just maybe say users optimized, something like that. Okay. It should not do that because you kind of broken your first rule that when you path your resources, you shouldn't be introducing like extra words that don't make sense. Okay. So what do we do? No, you cannot change this. So on your server side, when you upgrade, if you were to upgrade to this version, half of the Android applications or half of your client users would not work because it thinks that the data looks like this. So for some reason, you need to keep both of them existing at the same time until maybe the first half, third generation users finally update the app, right, and they all start using this one. Or some apps they do this, they send you a blocker so you cannot use until you update. Right. Okay. But some people like complain, I know that. Or maybe because your worst case, your app was made for Android OS 9, then your update was for OS 10. And the old users cannot upgrade the phone because they start on 9. You know how it's like Samsung or the phone companies never upgrade your Android OS on 9, unless you use Google Pixel. So for some reason, you need to keep these two things together. That how do you coexist two different responses on the same, almost on the same path? So therefore, we've introduced this thing called API versioning. You still need to change some things. So I need to keep this. Okay. Then I will introduce the second version here by creating another URL. So the idea of creating URL doesn't mean I start changing the resource name. I don't want to change the resource name because users come under the users class. Change the resource name, I create another class, name it in a way that doesn't fall in context in the way I design the REST API. So the most logical sense is to do prefix pathing. So before the user, I can introduce a V2 counting to say that this is a version 2. Okay, so where did I get the idea from? I got the idea from Facebook. Okay, if you have tried to look at Facebook, okay, not this. Or tools. So Facebook is a ecosystem that changes constantly. When so many users on desktop, mobile, and everywhere, and they are constantly introducing improvements, how do they manage all these things? They cannot just throw in a replacement IEPN and break something because you have apps. If your website, it doesn't really matter. It's easy because the more you build a Facebook website, you're getting the latest so-called client files, which is JavaScript. Now, if you're a mobile application, some users just don't want to upgrade. Okay, so that's why they have these versions. So this is actually the URL, the API, what the API is. Get me, right? So like my information, which is I want to fish out my ID and name. And among this, I already have like 5, version 2.11 to version 5. Okay, what about the earlier than 2.11? So all that they finally can discard it because no one uses it already. So if you look at Facebook, this is a classic case of maintaining very old things in order to move people ahead. So up to version 5, which is the latest, you have people even still using accessing the version 2.11 of the API. Right? So this is one of the examples. Like the way they do it is to add this prefix before the URL. Same thing you can do in your code. So come back to here. I have these two get users, right? They're gonna be different. They need to be different and they need to exist together. So what would I do? Now, idea number one, should I like add one more method here under users? Okay. So I have a basic. So here's a basic get one, right? This will be a path parameter. Path ID. So let's say this thing is a path parameter ID. Okay. And yep, get from database, return the thing. So first version is this, import that. Okay. So my first version, this one, assuming like this one, right, gives me this gigantic amount of data. Okay, not good enough. Need to make a second version. Do I come in here and add another method? Well, probably not, because this thing is housed under users. So if you're gonna create a new generation of methods for this resource, one of the ways you can do is under resources. So I'm thinking ahead. If I'm going to eventually replace users resource with something else that offers better methods that for my new client application. Okay. So maybe I start doing this. P2 users. So what I do is to create like a sub, another sub class exactly the same name, but housed under another package, V2. I could like copy everything here, okay. Or wait, extend the implements. So I could also, because it's gonna be the same thing, right? Except I'm gonna overwrite some of the stuff I have. So maybe I'll just do this one. Okay. So you can also do this in Java because you know your classes can inherit a class, override the classes aspects, right? So you can do this, inherit your original user class so you maintain all the methods, you don't need to rewrite them again because you don't want to do that. And just write a method to override the one that you want to provide. Change the path to these users. Okay. The one I want to override is this guy. Of course, do this and then I need to annotation for override. Yeah. So here, this method, which is this is the V1 method or the V2, sorry, it should be V2. Okay, will give me a different response compared to the V1 here. So until a date when everything has been like sort of been overtaken by the new user resource class, then I might actually put this one to rest. So this is the idea with versioning. The reason why you need to do this is coexistence of methods under the same resources. Okay. It's also a bit more organized by doing this. Now, how other methods can we do this other than a path? Well, of course, there are other methods. If I don't want to have a path like this to specify the separate difference, right? I could also use headers, but it might be a bit like kind of overkill and too transparent. Okay. The reason why path is so that when I'm as an application developer on the mobile app, I'm actually very aware that this version is calling V2 or V3 or 2 point something. So it actually helps me as a human understand what I'm doing. Okay. So, right, V1, V2. You can also implement this in your HTOS. When you return a state, sometimes your certain states, like the data needs to use a V2 on the method, you can do that too. Okay, so last feature that I'm going to go through is called pagination. And pagination is simply for the fact that nothing is infinite and bandwidth is also not infinite. That's because if you were to look at one of the key resources in your money transfer app, which is called transaction, just like you do iBanking, UOB, DBS, when you retrieve your transactions, the bank also very stingy. They never let you see the entire history of transactions since the day when you create an account, right? Yeah, in fact, they only let you see, I think, this month plus last month, probably 60 days. Yeah. Why? Because if they let you see everything from the day you started, I think their system will go haywire. I think they cannot support also. So, in here, transactions. You know, transactions can happen like, you know, have a happy, send 10 cents also can. Hundreds a day, for whatever reason, right? So the smart way to get around this is by pagination. You don't want to return back every application 1 million rows of data or a very absurd number of data because, number one, you will chuck up your bandwidth on the server. That means other users will have issue accessing your server. You'll get a bad gateway or server not responding. Number two, you queue the user's data plan. I know you all have like Circles Live, 10 gig, 12 gig, 15 gig data, but still there's another way to do it. Okay? And number three, the user will wait very long to download the data, even though we're going to 5G. Okay? So smart way and optimized way is do not waste, paginate your information. So Facebook application. You all know Facebook app, right? Facebook app has a scrolling thing. So as you scroll through the newsfeed, you just go like this, and this, and this, and this. So if that is your UI for implementing list view, okay, rather than traditional list view is like my old school list view. You show you 10 items, then below have an arrow, next page. Then another arrow like your, who's the VCR days like here? VCR, tape recorder. You got two play button, right? One looks like one single arrow there. The other is a single arrow and a stop sign there. Let me go to the end. Okay. So old school pagination on website, right? You have the single arrow next page and one more go to the end. Okay. So modern application, modern UI, you no longer have this kind of thing. People just want to scroll. Why? It's kind of entertaining, addictive, maybe. Can get to see the reason why you get to see all the information on the way. So your Android application has a scroll for transaction. So I think a scroll, you will hit the end and you need to retrieve next set of data. So when the person first goes to transaction here, user transaction, okay, then you decide how much information will I want to return. So let's go to transaction. Okay, now get users 101. Transactions. You don't return the world. So if you were to return a list, typically in the JSON it will be an array like this. Okay. And here you have date, time, okay, amount. Okay. Sender, and recipients, something like that, and maybe a status. Okay. So if you have 100 of this, then of course this will be very long. Okay. So first of all, decide in your application how many you want to display or how far the user can scroll the app. So assuming they can scroll maybe 20 entries, or you will display 20 entries before they need to get the next page, right? So 20 entries means your page size is 20. First information is page size. And then when they go to the end and scroll again, you will call the API to say, fetch me the next 20. Or then fetch me the next 20 again, right? So how will the data look like? Okay, so instead of a list, it's going to be an object. One way to do it is object. You may so have the data itself, which is the list. Okay, so this data attribute will contain the actual transaction objects in the JSON. And followed by next. Okay, then you want what's next? Next basically is users 01 transactions. Something that tells your REST endpoint that hey, I'm gonna get page 1 or page 2, page 3, page 4, until either this thing is a complete empty string, means there's nothing left, end of page. So this is pagination. Previous batches were actually pagination with under using the traditional UI of back previous and more, you have more things done. They even have a previous, right? OA, even total pages. Total pages. So that could be also a thing. 100 pages. Or maybe like total records. Okay. So, That's not the deal with pagination. Pagination basically is focused on these two things. Previous you may not even use it because when you're scrolling in an application, because as you scroll down, all the previous information is actually rendered into the app. So there's no need to retrieve a previous. It's not an old school next previous page. Yeah. So whatever is rendered stays there, so the user can always scroll back and see. There's no need to make another call to the server. So effectively the previous link. You only need links. And maybe you might have this page size. Okay, why page size, right? Because some people have very big phones, you can display more information. Some people have smaller phones, you may want to have lesser. Up to you. Or you can make it easier online, you can just stay at one number. So these parameters, they'll be sent via query string to the question mark here. So your endpoint for pagination need to actually pick up, maybe for this case, two values, page number and page size, and then determine on the database side how and where to fetch the rows from. So for pagination, you have one aspect which is the REST API, the implementation part. The next one is the MySQL, how to retrieve the next page. So I always like to do this. So if page size is 20, okay, and I'm requesting for page 3. So in the database, everything starts from 0, right? 0 to X number of rows, okay? So question is, which row in the DB do I start? From. Or let me rephrase, which row index? So you need to know, because you need to calculate. Does anyone know the answer? What do you want now? Each one starts from 0, right? Each one starts from 0. record on one. Let's record one lah. Database is start from which database? Oh, sorry, okay. Yeah. So, total number of rows in PBI. Data. So, if I want to retrieve page 3, page size is 20, where do I start? Which row do I retrieve from? Right? So start from 41, pick 20 lah. That's if your index in the row in DB start from 1 lah, the row. Your index, if your row in the DB start from 0, then it's 40, take 20.
Depends.
Depends on the index. That's correct. Does everyone agree the answer? You understand how you get the answer, right? Why is it 41 or 40? So this is if index start from 1 and the other one if index start from 0. Okay, so when you're doing this in MySQL, see, is it limit? Offset limit, yep. Offset limit. Okay. Offset limit. Okay. Limit 2. Okay. So this is database part. So there's this keyword in database called limit. Now I can see. So limit basically returns is the number of limits the amount of data retrieved. Okay, but the problem with limit is that it's based on the first row onwards. So you can't specify a start yet. So I think I use is offset. So here we have, okay, this is the possible options in the select statement you can use. Of course, we always use a very small subset of this thing. Limit, okay. So limit allows you to specify two parameters in this format. First, you specify offset, and then follow by row count. Row count means how many rows you want to retrieve, okay. Or you can say row count, then offset, specify offset. So there's like a short form method. So if I say I want to limit right 2 2. Okay. So if I use limit 2 2, this first parameter in MySQL defines offset. Offset means where do I start from? Okay. Second parameter tells MySQL how many records retrieve. So is MySQL a zero start 0 or start 1 item? Start from 0 or start from 1. Let me take away this thing, right? Okay. Let me duplicate this. Okay. So how many users are there? I have 4 users. ID starting from ID 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. So when I do limit 0 to offset is limit, offset is 0. Yeah, start from row 0. I pick 2. Okay? It'll give me the first 2, 7, 8. If I change to limit 2, 2, you give me the next 2, 9, 10. Which is here. So when you do limit or whatever syntax in the database system, Oracle, Postgres, MS SQL, there's always this option to pick rows by when you start and then how many you will take. So all of them have similar I mean, similar concept, different syntax. Like, MySQL is called limit, and then SQL Server is something else. Right? You use SQL Server? So you know the syntax, right? Okay, no testing. Okay, so this is the idea. So why is this important is, let's say my page size is 20, page is 3, because your Android app will probably tell your page to retrieve. Probably when you calculate the start or the offset. So this 40 or 41 is the one you need to calculate. But then you may ask the question, can my Android app just send what row to retrieve from? Also can. Yeah. If you don't use the concept of page, you can also say offset. Still the idea of pagination, just that you're transferring that data directly to your SQL statement. That's all. Okay. So in order to achieve pagination, notice that the object return has definitely the data or list that will store the array. Then you also have like these few things, next and whatever you like to return. So in case, let's say your app want to display total pages or some kind of progress bar, then you might need these total pages or total records. So the user knows that, oh, I need to end and end. Otherwise you scroll endlessly. Okay. So I think slide has some examples, but it's quite straightforward to get an idea. How are we passing the parameters, the request, right? Like how do I tell the REST endpoint I want page 2 of the data? So it's via this thing called query strings. So when you write the method to respond, to handle this particular method, this particular request, you want to, like, depending on what you kind of query string parameters you want to capture, like page size, or maybe offset or something else. So up to you, limit. Okay. So have a break. Then I'm gonna come back and implement this in a Eclipse project. Thank you.